First of all, Ramakant Garu, you have been a really big support for ESL, and many, many students have benefited because of your interaction with ESL. You know, we have a very good relationship with Crest Engineering because of you. And now Crest Engineering is planning to, I got a message from Prakash Garu recently saying he wants to hire all ESL students.
Wonderful.
So that is a really big accomplishment for ESL. Your conversation has helped us to write the, you mentioned in the last conversation when you had with us, you said there are three things that we look for in an interview. One is the attitude, second is communication skills, and third is technical skills.
Right.
And you said you do a 10 rating on each one of them, and you add up all the, you know, someone might have attitude of 8, and then communication skills might be 5, and technical skills might be 3. Then overall will be 60.
Right.
And you mentioned that. So students were very surprised about that. They thought only technical skills was going to be the highest, and then everything else comes.
Okay.
So because of that, we wrote a book called Be a Tope at the Interviews. So students really spoke with a lot of people, and they realized the importance of attitude. And I think that is the reason Crest Engineering wants to hire ESL students, because of their attitude.
Yes. Actually, this partly came with the discussions we used to have with Mr. Prakash. Like we both were sitting and discussing what is better, like which one, whom should we hire? Is it the attitude person or is it the top technical person? Okay. Then after certain discussion, like pros, cons and things like that, arguing against for and things like that, finally we realized that attitude should be the top, given the priority number one. Okay. And then comes technical and communication skills, because technical, of course, you need some technical skills for a company like Crest, where we are doing most of the work is technical. Whereas for a marketing kind of company, probably the communication skills would take a preference over technical skills. That's
right.
How we came out and then said, okay, first let us have the attitude first, because a person who has a good attitude, a good team spirit, a person who wants to really go get attitude, or even support each other and things like that in times of crisis or in times of this any other learning and things like that, then we will have that will be a better person in the long run, as we have seen. And they will be good for not only themselves but for the society in general. So
yes,
that's how we came up with that formula, and then said, okay, you have the attitude also to be included as a part of the interview.
Thank you. So before we go further with this,
you know, okay.
Yeah, I think you are fine, Ramakant Garu.
Okay.
Yeah. Let us do this. We always start with the invocation. And so let us get the invocations, you know, let us do the invocation first. Sandhya, please.
Yes, sir. This is who we are. We are a team, talented, energetic, astonishing mindsets. We can do anything and everything. We talk, we care, we respect each other. We see beauty in everyone and everything. We are connected by hearts and driven by values. We celebrate each other. We provide values to others. We take ownership in everything. We have freedom to make mistakes. We learn as we go. We are mad to make a difference. We love disruptive ideas. We make impossible things possible. We are strong to question the creation. We believe in dreaming big. If you do not dare to dream big, Are we really living? Why be ordinary when we can be extraordinary? This is who we are. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sandhya. So Ramakankar, that was really very well done, because we understood, because of that particular conversation, we understood the power of attitude. And then we started having conversations with many other companies, and then we started asking them these questions, like, what about attitude and communication? And then they also started telling us, attitude is what we would like to see, because technical skills we can teach, but trying to teach attitude is very hard. So that really got, that was one of the other things you helped ESL in a big way. It might have been just a conversation for 1 hour, but it created a huge project in ESL for several months. So now the next thing which we are trying to do is, what are the things that the students have to learn in their 4 years? Okay. Technically, because you're a chemical engineer and you have worked in so many industries, we want to not hear general things, what they should learn, but specific things. Like, should they learn about pumps? Should they learn about heat exchangers? What exactly should they learn and how should they learn? Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, my presentation will sort of touch upon those same aspects that you have raised. Okay. I have prepared the presentation. Probably it should last about 15 to 20 minutes. Okay.
Do you want to start with the presentation?
Yeah, we can start with the presentation. I can show it to you. Shall I start?
Yeah.
If you have any other questions, we can all...
No. This is our main question.
Then if that is the main question, we can start our presentation. Okay. I thought maybe when I spoke to Triveni, or when I wanted to give some small talk, I thought maybe this is where I see there is a disconnect in the students when I speak to them. They always learn all the subjects, but there is no handshaking in between the subjects.
Okay.
So that's where, as a chemical engineer, we need to look at it in an overall sense. Okay. It's not that we will be expert in all the subjects, but at least we should know how they connect to each other, how do we think while reading some other subject about another subject. Okay, so without much this one, I'll go into the next slide. Okay, here, for example, these are the, on the left-hand side, I have written chemical reaction engineering, mass transfer, heat transfer, fluid mechanics, process dynamics, thermodynamics. These are the main subjects, the core subjects that we typically, as chemical engineers, we do look into it. Okay, and in the chemical reaction engineering, typically what we do, we work with the reactors, for example, PFR, CSTR, batch reactor, and then we try to see how much is the conversion, what is the yield, what is the, what should be the size of the reactor, and those are the things that we look into when we really learn. If you look at the whole chemical reaction engineering book, we used to follow, I guess, Octave Levenspiel. Most of it is based on the how to, initially it is about the reactions, but at the end, all these things end in how to design the reactor. Okay. So that is where we look at the reactors for, as a chemical, look at chemical reaction engineering for the reactors. Okay. And then we, for the mass transfer operations, we look into the separators mainly, where there is no reaction, but typical separations, for example, distillation column. This is one of the major major thing that as chemical engineers we use in any chemical industry, let it be batch reaction or more in the continuous reaction, especially the petroleum industry, okay, where we separate multi-components using the distillation. And then there is another solvent extraction equipments. This is typically used in mining industry, where we take out mines and minerals from the reaction from the soil, separate them out. We use many different operations. Okay. And then we, apart from that, we also use them in the pharmaceutical industry, where we extract many a times the substrate or the product from one liquid to another liquid to improve to purify and things like that. So that is where we use the solvent extraction. SX represents solvent extraction. Filtration, of course, filtration is necessary when you need to separate solid liquid things. So like this, we use the separators or mass transfer operations in the design of the separators, basically. Okay. And then for heat transfer, we use heat exchanger equipments, mostly Schlein tube heat exchanger or air cooled heat exchanger. This will give the background, and then later we'll go little faster. Evaporators and condensers, these are there, and then we also use heat transfer in reactor jackets, okay, where we impart temperatures, we either heat or cool the solvents for the reaction in the batch industries. And then we use fluid mechanics in the pumps, design of pumps, valves, and we measure the pressure drop calculations and things like that, which are one of the most prominent uses of fluid mechanics in the petroleum industry, especially. That's very, very important. And then process dynamics control, we use automatic temperature pressure controllers, or we use cascade controllers, feed forward, feed backward controllers. We all are learning to have an idea of how they work in the industry. Okay. We may not become the experts in that, because there are other fields who are there, but we at least need to know these things. And then for the thermodynamics, we use thermodynamics for properties predictions, and also for the simulations for many other batch and continuous process industries. We use simulation mostly in the continuous process industries, where we can simulate and understand how the scale up, scale down things will work. Okay. So next, equipment design. Okay. All these things we lead to the equipment design. For example, in the reactors, we use the information for the reaction, the reactor, for example, how much, what is the area or volume that is needed. And for the separators, we distillation and filtration equipment, heat exchanger. Area is the primary design of the heat exchanger. So we, most of us, when we are asked to look at design a heat exchanger, we think that it is the number of tubes or shell and tube, we are not very clear, but as a chemical engineer, we are looking at the area of the heat exchanger to be designed or to be calculated, and then from there comes the further things. And then the flow measuring devices, for example, temperature, pressure, and flow concentrations. These are the measuring devices which we use. Various things which we study in the chemical engineering. For example, fluid mechanics is being used for pressure and flow measurements. Temperature, material properties, and then for the concentration, we also again use material properties and things like that. So different. These are the flow measuring devices that we use. We may have to design sometimes, especially when I was doing my master's and PhD, where we had to set up our own lab, our own measuring equipments. We had to measure the flow meters. We couldn't get flow meters. We didn't have enough budget to buy the flow meters. We had to make our own YouTube kind of flow meter, where we have to make design one, and then ensure that we measure the flows accurately based on the manometer based readings. Okay. So similarly, automatic controllers, like we have PID, PDPID, the feed forward, feed backward controlling. In the industry, we need to know how and what to control so that we can improve the these parameters to get the correct accurate control. For example, in one of the reactions that we had when I was working in Dr. Reddy's, we had a very small window, like the reaction should not exceed 2 degrees plus minus. If it exceeds 2 degrees greater than this, then we would get a product which is not desirable, or rather impurities would be high. And if it is lesser, then the reaction wouldn't happen. It would take, instead of taking the reaction taking about half an hour, it would go beyond 3-4 hours. So that was the very small window we had to work on. So we had to tamper with the controllers and then ensure there was feed forward, feed backward. We took an entire look at, I had to learn about controllers and then read about it and then again say, okay, this is what it means. Went and controlled it and we could achieve that. So that's how the knowledge, if we have, then we will apply it later when, as and when we get the opportunity in our career. Okay, so that is the thing. So another, how are the relations? The next slide is the relation between the subjects. For example, CRA and heat exchanger. This is heating the reactor in a jacketed vessel. Many a times we have a jacketed vessel and then we assume that it will get heated. But if it is a, if a reactor of the, let's say, 1 kiloliter or 1,000 liters reactor, to get it heated to from 25 degrees to almost, let's say, 70 degrees centigrade, it would take more than half an hour to 40 minutes based on the on the temperature of the fluid. Even if we have almost steam, it would take about half an hour for it. So we have to understand that it is just not the temperature in the lab. Typically, what will happen? We put the we use a small reactor, small glass bottle or glass beaker. Put it in a water bath. Okay. Water bath is maintained at, let's say, 70 degrees. The moment you put it, within half a minute or maximum 1 minute, your reactor, the reaction content, reactor temperature and the contents temperature will reach almost 70 degrees centigrade. And then you do the reaction for half an hour and you know that reaction is complete. Okay, you measure and then you see the reaction. Whereas in the plant, if you assume that the temperature will come within half an hour, then it is very, it's a big myth. So we have to, then what is that which controls the temperature rise? If we don't know the heat exchanger, if we don't connect the heat exchanger, then we will realize, then we will miss out as to how we can get the temperature faster. So that's where we use the heat exchange. We use the heat exchanger, like the UA delta T. So we use that equation and then get the see what is the maximum rate of heat transfer, and from that we can calculate how much time it will take for the vessel contents to get heated to a desired temperature. So that is the. And the other one is PDC. As I just told you, the temperature control of temperature is we need PDC in the reactor, and mass transfer and operations and PDC. For example, continuous distillation operations, we use many controllers on the distillation column to ensure the temperatures and the pressures are maintained. Okay, if there is a slight variation in the temperature, then we get a different spec product. And if there is a disturbance in the feed or in the coolant or a steam line, then we get a difference in temperatures, and then we get different spec products, which typically are not acceptable many a times. Okay, that's how the PDC and mass transfer operations, distillation column, connected. Similarly, thermodynamics, we use a lot of, you all know about Pro2. Pro2, thermodynamics is like the blood of Pro2. Okay. So if you if there is no thermodynamics, we will never be able to predict the properties of any liquid stream, any stream in particular. So thermodynamics forms, it is like a blood in the human body. Like that, thermodynamics, there its calculations form the core thing in the Pro2 in any continuous simulation. And we call flash operations in the Pro2 as the heart of the Pro2, like so, or any other simulation, okay, simulation package including Aspen, ChemCAD, whatever. So that is how these thermodynamics is one of the most important aspect if you are looking at simulations or predicting the properties. If not, then it is not a big issue. Okay, so that's the thing. Similarly, I have listed down a few more, like heat transfer and PDC, environmental engineering in the CRE, in the design of aerobic and anaerobic reactors, in the environmental, the control of these chemical oxygen demand, when we sewage or effluents from any, this one we use design of anaerobic and aerobic reactors. And similarly, for if we want to design a flare stack design, like for example, flare stack, I don't know how many of you know, it is a big chimney which is present in many industries, where you have to burn off a few things to either to heat a boiler and things like that, or to reduce the effluents, or if you want to let off few solvent vapors which are which you cannot control them, then you send it into the flare where they get burnt and then they come out as carbon dioxide, hydrogen, which are not environmental, like it, which are not toxic to the people. So that is where we use this is what I was telling okay initially.
Oh, yes.
On the left hand side are the typical core subjects, and on the other things are given here. Okay, like I more or less told them out.
Right.
Okay, like reactors, separators, these are all the things that we use in the chemical engineering. Okay, then the other thing is equipment design. In the reactors, we use mainly the reactor design is based on the volume or area. That is where we use. Are you able to see this slide?
Yes, yes.
Dimensions of the reactor. Equipment design is the title of the slide.
Yes, we can see.
Yeah, okay. So heat exchanger, area is the primary design of heat exchanger as far as chemical engineers are concerned. Okay. When it comes to detailed design of this one, mostly it is done by the mechanical engineers who do take the area as the primary input, and they optimize on the volume of the heat exchanger, okay, and the materials of the heat exchanger. For example, if you want to like how much material is needed, how to minimize the material, how to minimize the volume occupied by the heat exchanger, that's what is the work of mechanics or those who do the heat exchanger design. But for as a chemical engineer, we expect you to give the area of the heat exchanger. Okay, we are expected to give them the area of heat exchanger because we know what is the process fluid which is coming, which needs to be cooled or heated, and then what are the utilities that we have. Do we have the steam or hot water for heating, and then for cooling, what is the cooling substance that we have, whether it is chilled water, brine, or any other refrigerant that is used to cool. So those are the different things that we need. Similarly, we need to use flow measuring devices and then controller feedbacks. Okay, I was on this slide where I was telling about the heat exchanger. Are you able to see the relation between the so this is where I had given like examples how the different subjects connect with each other to for us to give the design of the plant in general. Okay, so that we can, as chemical engineers, we need to sometimes get into the role of designing a big plant. Okay, so we have to design individual equipments and then connectivity, and then we have to also get into pressure drop calculations and all those things. Okay, so for example, I just gave an example of heat exchanger design. How do we go about it? I have been talking about the heat exchanger area and things like that. So size of the heat exchanger is determined by its area of the heat transfer. The main governing equations are like Q is equal to UA delta T or LMTD, where Q is equal to MCP delta T or Q is equal to M lambda or a combination. Okay. So, and the heat transfer coefficient U is 1 by HI plus 1 by HO plus that conductivity L by K. Okay. 1 by L by K, where I think there is a small mistake there. Okay. That is where HI and HO are the estimated using this equation. Nusselt number is equal to Reynolds number and Prandtl number. So based on these, we can estimate the Q value. Once we have the Q value, we know in the main, in this equipment, in the governing equation, this one, we have, we can, once we estimate the U, then we know the delta T constraints. Typically, delta T constraints in the industry, there will be delta T constraints. For example, cooling water rise, temperature rise should not be more than 10 degrees centigrade or 10 degrees Kelvin. Okay, then we'll have you cooling water which is available at, let's say, at 25 degrees centigrade. And then we have to ensure that outlet of the cooling water should not be more than 35 degrees centigrade. Because why is this? Because this hot water goes back into the cooling tower. The right. Cooling tower, again, this hot water is allowed to fall from the top of the cooling tower. And then it as it comes down, it evaporates and cools. Okay. So the amount, the size of the cooling tower, the height, the humidity constraints, those are the things which will make us that which will limit us to bring down the temperature to a maximum of or a minimum of 25 degrees centigrade only. So that's why we say, okay, this is the cooling tower. We need a maximum temperature rise can be 10 degrees Kelvin or 10 degrees centigrade. Okay. And then there is one more constraint like heating rate. We have a steam which is available for us at a particular temperature or a pressure. Typical boilers, they work at 4 to 5 bar maximum in the normal industry. Of course, if you go to the thermal power stations and all, they work at a much higher, but typical industrial boilers work anywhere between 2 bar to 5 bar pressure. So when maximum temperature is defined based on the pressure. So we'll get approximately 120 to 130 degrees centigrade maximum for the steam. So that will be your 120 to if you want to to reduce that, then you will have the latent heat, and then you may, if you further use it for cooling, then it will, you will have the sensible heat also, which you can utilize for heating your process liquid. So this is how we try to get the area of the heat exchanger. Like we know delta T or LMTD, we know Q, it is dependent on the equipment. U is never dependent on any other process conditions or anything. It is mostly dependent on the equipment, and we, that can be calculated separately based on the size of the equipment and the conditions within the equipment. Okay, so that is what we when you ask Proto to do the calculations, I give the area of heat exchanger, it inside it does all these things, and then it gives us the area of the heat transfer. Okay, now for the reactor,
one second, no? Yeah. Dr. Ramakandar. Yeah. So students, so when you are hearing all these things, look, you know, the terms, some of you, you know, first year students, you don't even know these terms, but make notes. So this way, what happens is these terms, when you hear it again, when you go and take your second year classes or somewhere, you start saying, oh, okay, I better pay attention to these terms. Oh, I better pay attention to U. I better pay attention to Nusselt number. So you start, when you start hearing these words more and more, you'll know that these are the words that I have to pay more attention to. Okay? So, thank you. Go ahead, Ramakant Garu.
Okay. That's really a good tip, Shravan. Okay. So, coming to the reactor design. Are you able to see this slide?
Yes.
Yeah. So, typically reactors, okay, one way of reactor design. How do we design the reactor? So, for example, if we do a lab, in the lab, we find out that 30-minute reaction with 90% conversion, then we need to have a hold time of minimum 30 minutes in the reactor. So, CSTR volume is based on the flow rate and the time of reaction. So, we know how much flow rate is needed and what should be the time we from the reaction. We get to know the time. So based on that, we typically design the CSTR. Similarly, the length of the PFR. PFR is plug flow reactor. CSTR is the continuous stir tank reactor. Okay. So plug flow reactor is like a tube. Okay. So the length of the tube is the residence time, and that will the diameter of the tube will determine the based on the flow rate of the reactant. Okay, so that is how we design the reactor. When we say, okay, what should the size of the reactor, then we typically expect an answer from the students, something like this. I don't, as an interviewer, okay, I wouldn't expect you to give me full, okay, the reactor should be, should have these, that, no. It is just that, okay, what is the, how much should be the minimum time? And how do we calculate? If we know some, these are nothing but basics, which probably if we look into it from the view of a layman, it becomes very easy to design the reactor. Okay. So a batch reactor volume depends on the amount of the product required and to produce, and then the total amount needed to again depends on the typically how much time or campaign or month. You know what is a campaign? Campaign is the typically these pharmaceutical industry, let's say, okay, they get an order. I want some 3,000 kgs of a particular product. Okay, so you so based on that, you may have to, you can do it everything 3 tons in one single go, or you don't equipment, so you have, let's say, a 500 liter reactor in which you can maximum load 400 liters. Mm-hmm. And then in that, typically the volume of the solvent is almost like 70 to 90%. Okay, so you about 90%, if we assume your each batch size will be hardly 30 to 40 kgs. Okay. So if we want 4,000 kgs, we have to run 10 batches. 100 batches. So depending on that, we design the reactor, we design our work force and our working style, or how much should go into batch size and things like that. Okay, and number of batches and how much time is needed. Based on that, the producer or the manufacturer says, okay, give me 1 month's time, I will deliver this product. Okay, so like that, based on that, we will get the reactor design. Now coming to the any questions in this third years.
Sir?
Yeah.
So can you come again?
Tribeni, he asked whether you have any questions.
Yes. No,
Any
sir, as
questions?
of now, we are listening to you. It is clear as of now.
Okay. Can I
So,
continue?
I have actually 1 second. Do you have a reactor design class in chemical engineering?
Yes, sir. You have completed CRE1.
Okay, so you do have that in CRE1 and CRE2. Okay.
I
So you.
remember my one of my final year project was the reactor design only. So I very clearly remember we have studied reactor design.
Okay, good. I don't remember at all, actually. I don't know how I forgot completely, but I did. So the next thing I have for the students is, when you're hearing all of these terms, especially third years and fourth years, are you feeling, is there any of these things which Ramakant Garu said have come in gate or have been asked in any interviews?
Yes, sir. See, a few of the questions have come in the gate.
Okay, good. So if you had this talk before GATE, you would have, learned those concepts a little more, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And then in the interviews, your 4th years, if you have gone for an interview, is any of the things till now what Ramakant Garu has said, have they been asked or anything like that? Okay, yes, okay, good. So this is definitely you're falling right, where we want. So go ahead, please,
Okay.
present.
So distillation column design. Now coming to the next topic of distillation. I'm just going, I am not going into those difficult equations and things like that. No. Because in an interview, no one expects you to remember the equations and things like that. Of course, small things like what is Reynolds number, probably that they will ask, dV rho by mu, okay, something like that. But other than that, people, as an interviewer, I wouldn't expect you to remember me many equations and things like that, even if you are. But I certainly want you to connect between the subjects and then say, okay, what is relevant and what is not so relevant and things like that. Okay, so that is where I am just giving this to help mostly you people to work on or be prepared for a technical round of interview. So this is mainly for that, and of course the other things we can only talk. Okay, and then okay, coming back to the distillation column design, we have both the two modes. One is continuous mode and batch mode. Continuous mode, mostly petroleum industries we use, where continuous operations are being done, whereas batch mode, most of the pharmaceutical industry works in the batch mode. So there also not many industries have continuous distillation column. Most of them are batch distillation columns, and then that is how, where it is being used. Okay, so what is important in this is what do we mean by the design of a distillation column? Expect design to be only two things, mainly the height of the column and the diameter of the column. Okay, what is the height of the column? Height of the column is number of trays plus some space on the top and the bottom and things like that, mainly, and then or the packing height. Instead of trays, there can be packing inside, and for that we use HETP, height equivalent to theoretical plate. Those are the things. Okay, if we know this, our whole Machiavelli method, Poincaré-Savarin method, they all give us this height of the column, or they give us the number of trays and things like that. Based on that, we determine the height of the column. Okay, and typically the tray spacings are anywhere between 1 feet to maximum 2 feet. Okay, so even sometimes slightly lesser also if we have a better dispersion and things like that. But on an average, if you can take most of the columns in the world, or at least 90% of them, will be between 0.75 no 0.5 meters, okay, 0.4 to 0.5 meters at the minimum, to maximum about 0.8 or 0.9 meters, less than 1 meter. Okay, that is the typical the height of the tray spacing, I would say. Okay, so how do we determine this height of the column? It is typically determined by the product concentrations that we need. Okay, so that is like what is the purity of the compound that we want, and based on that we get the number of trays. The higher the purity we need, the more will be the number of trays. So that's how the height will also increase. Okay, and this comes from the VLE diagram that we all know, vapor liquid equilibrium diagram, the binary diagram. And also in some cases we also need to consider some reflex ratios and things like that. Okay, so as a interviewer, I would say, okay, how do you determine the height of the column? Then you immediately the question should be asked like, okay, what are the purities that you are expecting? Based on the purity only the height of the column will come. Okay, then what will be the diameter of the column? If I ask, if someone asks you, okay, design a distillation column, you are only at the end of the day give the height of the column, number of trays, and the diameter of the column. This is what you can give at the most. That is what is expected as a chemical engineer. And then finer aspects of designing the column and all, that is a more involved thing unless you go into a industry where their main work is fabrication of distillation columns or the packing things, for example, Schulze or Koglitz kind of companies. Then only you will be more interested in the internal designs and then pressure drops and all those things, which we don't have to worry at the B.Tech level. Okay, that's more of a worry at higher M.Tech or Ph.D. kind of thing. Okay, the diameter of the column again comes, the flow rate of the feed is the main thing that determines the height of the column. Okay, again, what do you mean by flow rate of the feed? It is the flow rates of the vapor and liquid that is coming out, rising. The vapor will be rising and the liquid will be coming down, and those will actually determine the height of the column. So in some cases, if you may see that the height of the column will be of two different sizes. Like as we go up, it becomes thinner, and as we come down, it becomes after certain section, the suddenly column diameter is wider than the top portion. That is mainly because that's where you need, there will be lot of liquid and vapor flow, which we need to accommodate for. So that's how the diameter of the column. And then in that again, we may have some pressure drop considerations when we are really working with the diameter of the column. It's not the height. The pressure drop is the worry of the diameter. Like if there is a higher pressure drop, then you increase the diameter, then there is more space for the vapor to flow. So that's how the pressure drop will decrease. Okay. Similarly, in the batch mode, height is again the composition purity considerations. The diameter is the same, like flow rates of the vapor, liquid reflux, and then volume of the kettle, that is the amount of solvent you need to be separating, or and also the rate of heating. Those things will determine the size of the batch mode, kettle or the bottom of the column, and then other things are similar to the distillation or regular continuous. Okay. Then we also look at now coming to the filtration setup. Just I thought I'll just give you some background. It's not filtration is not is a process mostly used in solid liquid separations, and it is mostly for the batch processing industry. You see, the filtration is one of the major things. For the continuous mode also it is there, but it is very less when you compare it to the batch. batch pharmaceutical industry, almost every stage, typically pharma, if you want to prepare one API is the active pharma ingredient, okay. It is something like, if you see a crocin tablet, in the crocin tablet, paracetamol is the API, and the crocin brand name of that of that tablet, where actual tablet may be of the size to of the weight 2 grams, but in that only 500 milligrams is the paracetamol typically. So that is the paracetamol is the one that reduces the your fever and things like that, body pains, fever and things like that. So in the API industry, we use, for after every stage, we typically separate out the solids, liquids, and improve the purity of the substance before it goes to the next stage. That's where a lot of filtration operations are seen in the API and the batch in the pesticide industry also. Okay. So again, this depends on the cake characteristics, like volume of the solids and the height of the solids, like for the pressure drop considerations, and whether the solids are crystalline nature or they are in amorphous or gel-like nature. Based on that, the difficulty of separation of filtration is experienced, and then comes the vacuum and pressure availability within the factory. That will be one of the reasons or the considerations for using which kind of filtration we should use. Okay. And then the filter media. Hello? Yeah. Did I hear anyone? Okay. Filter media is the filter cloth. Okay. It's sometimes it may not be cloth. It could be a fine mesh of iron or something.